Morning or good evening. Welcome to the last week of the regular season for the Archon Team League Championships. My name is Frodan, and today I'm joined by Kriparian and Noxious to bring you guys the action. This is what it all boils down to. We've been playing for 7 weeks already, and today begins week number 8. Well, we'll find out who is going to the playoffs, who is going to redemption, and well, I think we already know who's eliminated, but we'll talk more about that in just a second. Let's first introduce our casters for today. Krip, how's it going?
That's going all right. Some pretty big hype today. We talked about all these point differentials, who's winning versus who, this and that. But today is all the marbles, and we don't really care about the point differentials at all. So basically, all the teams that are 4-2, which are the top four teams in the tournament right now, will all be playing each other today. So today we'll find out who gets a secure spot for the final. The first two on the list of 8 go through the final directly in this stage of the tournament. And the rest, well, they have more adventures to go through.
Yeah, that's right. Noxious, you've been casting, I feel like, more than both of us so far. Maybe you and Krip are tied, but definitely more than me. How's the journey been for you being able to cast so much ATLC and getting up to this point?
No, it's actually been crazy. There have been a lot of games that were, like, for the level of play, you wouldn't expect necessarily all those crazy games to happen, because very frequently you'd assume that they're going to play and everything's going to be consistently similar, but there have been, missed lethals with Patron Warrior, among other things. And today I'm pretty excited to see how it's going to go between Temple Storm and Value Town, because Kibler and Hyped are the first two, right, in the race for the Master of Duels title. So whoever wins today is not only going to secure a top two spot, but they're also going to potentially race ahead of their opponent for that title.
Potentially. It's not necessarily the case. Like, for instance, Kibler can, like, 2-0 some random guys from Tempo Storm, and then, his team might still lose. It's possible, right?
And they don't get the grand final, so...
I believe in terms of the player rankings, they have the same number of wins, and Hyped has one additional loss over Kibler when it comes to that title.
Gotcha. And the winner of the Master of Duels, which is the best individual performance throughout the Archon Team League Championships, will receive $5,000 extra bonus. So it is a statistical thing. It's not like a subjective vote based off players, like who is the MVP for their team. It's based off Kibler performed the best in terms of win-loss ratio.
I vote for Frozen Eyes, so I think he should get a Master of Duels.
Well, the thing is, even those statistics have... they still have like some subjectivity, because winning the first few games with solid decks for your team is very different from winning the last few games in a best of 11. So, yeah, there's a lot that goes into it, but we got to go by something, so that seems good enough.
That's right. So, as mentioned by Noxious and Krip, our first match today will be Temple Storm versus Value Town, but we have two matches. The second one is also very hype. It's Nilum versus Cloud9. So, those two teams will be playing for a playoff spot as well. They're guaranteed second based off what happens today. Pretty cool how it lined up. Let's go ahead and take a look at the first beginning looks at the lineups that we have for these two teams. We have Mage, Warrior, Hunter, Shaman, Paladin, and Warlock for Temple Storm. And then over in Value Town land, we have Warlock, Warrior, and then we have Hunter and Priest from Kibler. That's interesting. And then
that is a little
Rogue
bit strange.
And Mage to close it out.
Yeah, Hype last week brought Blingtron Mech Mage. He's kind of been bringing like a little bit of different flavor each week. Maybe a little bit deliberate, but we talked to him a bit, and he just feels some of these decks are just really strong. So he likes to keep up with what he thinks is going to work each week, and each week that seems to change a little bit. So it's going to be a bit hard to predict what comes out of Hyped, but more than likely we'll see Patron Warrior. As far as Kibler's side, to keep this Master Duel talk going, Priest I think has not been a particularly consistent class in this tournament.
It's interesting because Priest is one of those classes where it doesn't seem good on paper, but sometimes it actually has weird win percentages where it's even good, like hypothetically speaking, and it's because the players that bring it are the ones that are comfortable with it. So they one, know the limitations, and they are naturally better with the deck than the average person play it. And the second is that this works in an entire lineup, so We've seen people like throw Priest out in the very beginning because they try to like surprise their opponents and not let the Priest get cornered at all, and then sometimes it sneaks a win. This happens sometimes in Conquest, but not sure how it'll fare today specifically when it's all on the line here in order to get a playoff spot. If they lose, they still get a chance to play through the Redemption Tournament as well as the second phase of the tournament. But you know, they definitely want to grab a win here today.
Yeah, and one thing that I find interesting is that the Priest doesn't really, since Shaman is now played so much, right? Like, it's one of those classes that Priest, if it's not a really crazy mech start, usually can handle the aggression. And if you build your Priest properly, you can probably even handle a good start from the Shaman, but you'd have to counter build for it specifically. Against Paladin, you can also do pretty well depending on how you build the deck. So the class still hasn't done too well in the entire event. Like, we saw Xyxo bring it, Shaki once, I think Gaara brought it, and it didn't go well at all for him that week.
Not at all.
So I can't quite say that Priest has been a particularly good pick for anyone who brought it, but maybe Kilbert is going to prove us wrong. You know, he's been doing super well so far.
Well, it looks like our opening game will be Eloise on Warlock and Dog and, on Rogue.
That makes no sense.
Okay.
All right.
Yeah. Dog is not on.
Well, no, he is. He is on that team, but I'm not sure if that Warlock deck is going to be good enough for Dog to handle. It's a really tough matchup, depending on what the Warlock brings.
Okay.
Yeah, I think in the past few weeks, Eloise has been bringing Zhu a lot. And even though she did bring Hainlock one time, I think, in ATLC, it feels like she's more been leaning towards the aggressive Zhu, or even sometimes a mix. Like, she'll throw in the deck list that has, like, the Enhanzo Meccano, for example, and really put her opponents off guard. But then she also has some demons in it as well.
Right.
And the Dark Bomb heavily indicates that it is a demon handlock.
I think from what we've seen of Eloise, like early on in the tournament, she was playing a lot of handlock though. So she's kind of made the switch recently.
Switch in the past recent weeks.
Yeah, but she's really a good Warlock player. In fact, I don't think there's a single week she didn't bring it. So that just goes to show. And yeah, I think the Molten Giant pretty much confirms this is handlock.
It's demon handlock. Yeah,
of course.
How does a demon handlock fare against Rogue compared to the normal handlock from what you guys have seen recently?
I don't know if I've ever seen this deck in tournament play personally.
I've seen Life Coach play it, but I can't say he's really run into. Like, back then, Rogue wasn't exactly super popular, so I don't have a good amount of experience with the matchup.
I would still say that it's really tricky because if my reading is correct, this deck still plays Mountain Giants, even though you do see Void Callers and Demons. Mm-hmm. And when you do have those threats, Rogue just has to outvalue itself. It has to spend two or three cards to remove one threat. Even if you have Sap, you need to have that Bio Teacher on board preemptively. And if you can get out a huge threat like an early Mal'Ganis, you're going to burn so much just to deal with it.
Well, that seems like it might be the case here. I think in the very traditional sense, Rogue has struggled quite a bit to deal with the handlock. But, you know, Rogue has changed to more of the weapon-style Rogue and less of the Miracle. And Warlock has, I guess, changed a little bit in today's match here with the demons evolved with the regular handlock cards. It feels like both these changes kind of favor the Warlock, though. I think most of the issues that the Rogue had is just really hard to get through those big taunts. I mean, here we see he's having to burn a sap on the Void Caller, and if the numbers don't match up properly, it's going to be really hard to get through the taunts later on in the game.
Yeah. There's something to be said as well about the how you're teching your Warlock, like Demon Handlock, because you could play, some versions don't run Lotheb. In tournament settings, I guess, you kind of have to play it, just because of the prevalence of decks that you can ruin just on the basis of that one card. But it's a deck that sometimes sees Lotheb being thrown out, and that's a really big deal, of course, in this matchup. And like some versions, like Life Coaches especially, didn't even run Mountain Giants, if I remember.
I mean, look at this turn we're about to have right now. Like, Dog loses his board completely. Eloise is at 19 life with a Mal'Ganis on the board.
Yeah, that's...
Yeah, she drops the health.
How do you recover from this?
Well, he uses Sap. That's the thing. And now he has to use...
He can still do it, though, right?
Other spells. Yeah, he's got to use a lot of health in order to do
Yeah, very easily, actually. Well, easily is a big word, but yeah, he can do it.
Well, he has to use Eviscerate. He has to use his weapon. I mean, is that really that easy? Like,
you're right.
Those,
right.
Those
okay,
giant
sure.
eyeballs of dog don't really agree with the okay. ease of play yeah. here.
Sure.
He's already had to use a lot of threats. The Warlock is at really high life. And, I mean, Eloise hasn't even used the Taunt Activator or a heal. Like, this Warlock deck has basically used almost nothing.
Yeah, and essentially he lost 6 damage from doing this too. Part of what makes Rogue potentially good against slower Warlock decks is the fact that you can always threaten a huge Blade Flurry and be able to double the damage. So if you have a 6 damage blade from a Deadly Poison and Tinker Sharpshot Oil, you can always threaten 12. But the problem is now he's already used up some of that burst, and so even though he has a hand that should hypothetically be able to go for 17 damage, he can't actually execute all of it because he lost half that dagger this turn.
He would have won, actually, if Mal'Ganis wasn't in that hand, I think.
Yeah, it would have maybe...
Right, would have been 21.
Yeah, that would have been enough.
That's a good point. And now... Dog is going to be hoping for sprint because at this stage, he almost has to just commit to doing damage and just hope that his opponent doesn't have big threats, which unfortunately, there is a Molten Giant on the other end. Oh, jeez.
Another Tinkers would also help probably quite a bit.
Yes.
That would actually be a pretty decent top deck if you look at the amount of damage output this pushes. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, if he gets the other Tinker, does he even have lethal? I think it.
He'd be up to 14.
He has to have lethal. Yeah, easily.
Yeah, he would actually have exact lethal if the heal bot comes down. So the other Tinkers is still lethal for the rogue player. So, oh man, Dog is hoping for that one for sure.
Yeah, but we're not very deep right now. Like, I think he has roughly 20 cards in his deck. 19. There we go.
Yeah, so.
Well, he just got the second prep, so.
That's right. Dropped a bunch of cards. Even floated a little bit of mana, so you're a little worried.
So Dog could find, let's say, Azure Drake into Deadly Poison, into Blade Flurry, and that would wipe the board completely. Right? Oh no, he'd be a little short because the weapon would be like one damage short. You need the other Tinkers with that play.
He doesn't need that card though.
That is not what he's looking for. Although he could still pick up.
You could get there's the Eviscerate. It was right after it. Is he technically dead? No, he's not technically dead if he eviscerates the Molten Giant and Blade Flurry is here. He's not dead to the board, but he is dead because of the Dark Bomb in Eloise's hand. So the first game here, unless something goes really tragically wrong, is going to go for Tempest Storm.
Right. Oh, she does run Mountain Giants. All right, so it's good to know.
Yeah, this deck does thrive off of playing. Like, this deck never runs out of threats, too, because I think Drax is also still in it. So the reason why is because you give up a lot of your mid-game. There's no Farseers, for example. You're probably still running with, like, one Hellfire, one Shadow Flame. So as a result, you're less like early game centric in terms of controlling the board, but you still have those big minions to pound down as like a ramp style. So this deck is just insane with a lot of big threats that keep coming down.
I'm surprised on how close that was though. I mean, you have to consider that Dog made the type of line of plays that would lead to a win at almost every single turn. And if Eloise didn't actually have a way to heal, he would have won that game.
I don't think it's that bad of a matchup for the rogue player. Like, I think all the Warlock matchups are pretty much a coin flip, like going in blind, and then maybe Demon Headlock is a slightly bit worse because you've got to deal with that extra Mal'Ganis on top of, you know, the possible Draxus double heal. So it depends really on what rogue, like, if he's running BGH, which isn't an auto include necessarily, then that also gives him a little bit of an edge in the matchup.
I suppose.
I guess there's two ways to look at it as well, based off of how this outcome has transpired. We saw that the Warlock was revealed, but the Warlock won. So usually the Warlock becomes a lot weaker after you reveal it, because then you can kind of line up whatever you want specifically. If you feel like you have something good against Handlock, if the Hunter, for example, is good against it, then you can try to corner it. But now that it's out of the way, it's a pretty big sigh of relief. And more importantly, it's like you said, even though Handlock and versus Rogue traditionally feels like it's Handlock favorite, I think Rogue players, especially players like Dog, feel very confident in it, generally speaking. So in this case, it's a very big win to be able to get the first point on the board for Templestorm.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. I'm kind of curious why you thought it was such a strange opener, Noxious.
I don't know. I feel like Eloise playing Warlock, she really masters it well enough that I'd keep the deck for maybe a bit later instead of throwing it blind. I would have maybe thrown the Paladin or the Shaman, just because typically in the league so far, we've seen a lot of people just throw their quote-unquote underdog decks. And if you can seal the first win with that, then usually navigating the rest is a little bit easier.
We've kind of seen... I don't know if it's really the underdog decks. I think it's just the decks that are fairly inconsistent. I think we've seen like a lot of Druid openers in the last few weeks. But at the same time, we've seen a lot of like Patron openers. I don't know. It feels like people just throw decks out there that have a pretty easy time against winning most things, not necessarily the niche decks. Like, I think a Priest is a class you want to pull out in a situation where most of the matchups will be against aggressive decks.
Yeah, when you've eliminated the rest, so you're right. With Handlock out of the way, that's still the rest, possibly, yeah. Yeah, we saw that happen last week.
Seems to come into effect almost every single matchup from what I've seen so far in the tournament.
Yeah, it ends up mattering. Well, Kibler with a Hunter. A little sad we're not seeing the Priest first, but it's going to be a Hunter mirror match. So, again, some people think this is one of the most intricate matchups when we're talking mid-range versus mid-range. I know RDU is a big fan of it with all the trap play. And now with the advent of Bear Trap, if mid-range Hunter is still a thing, we might actually get even more trap play.
It'll still be a thing. Anything that's not... Yeah. Apparently anything that's not like direct face damage is considered mid-range. Or like hybrid is like even starting to be called mid-range nowadays because of like how fast the Hunter is, and generally speaking, you still play mid-range-esque elements of it with board control stuff like Freezing Trap. I expect R to bring hybrid Hunter here. I would be surprised if Kibler chose to go for a more mid-range-centric approach, like really slow. I'm talking about like topping out at Dr. Boom and high main type of thing. I think hybrid's the way to go nowadays.
I feel Gaara, like, every single time he's brought a deck that seems standard, has always had some flavor in it to kind of not really fully classify it as that.
Yeah.
Right.
He's so, on Templestorm. It has to be.
Yeah. Yeah.
It's actually a rule we put in all our contracts. You're not allowed to net deck 30 cards for someone else's deck.
Yeah. Like, I think it was a few weeks ago when he was playing mid-range Hunter, but he just had, like, an explosive trap in there. And I think he had one of each trap. He had, like, one explosive, one snake, one freeze or something.
The prismatic Hunter.
I don't remember exactly what it was, but it was something like that. And it just was a bit weird. And it did make a difference. Like, it threw his opponents off. When the deck only has to win one game, if you throw off your opponent and you get a decent draw, it's going to be effective enough.
Gotcha. Well, while we have a quick second here, I want to mention that Friday we're going to be playing the Redemption 6th and 7th place spot, so make sure to go ahead and check that action here again on Amaz's channel. And we do want to bring awareness that this recording is live. It's not pre-recorded casting at all. Today we did have the Tavern Brawl released with TGT, and which means the 24th we'll be having the Grand Tournament cards available, and we will have it played in the ATLC as soon as it's live, which is very, very, very exciting. So, just wanted to distract you guys with that.
I have a prediction. I think the best card in TGT will be Grim Patron.
Right, sick. Because what Blizzard tends to do is release cards before the next set, so that way it'd be playable, right?
Right,
Grim
exactly.
Patron was just it was a precursor. You thought you saw a lot. Now, just wait till TGG releases.
Oh man, what an awful hand here from Kibler. Really bad start with explosive trap, quick shot. And then again, Gaara is also not quite hitting the two drops. So
yeah, and here we see a little bit of strange stuff. I mean, Arcane Golem in the same hand as Freeze Trap, so that's a bit weird.
Yeah, I think that's very hybridish. And you could be right. Gaara might be still running like the explosive freezing split, but. We'll see. I mean, both these guys have really awkward hands right now.
Mm-hmm. Well, I think Gar is not actually that awkward. I mean, he kind of misses a turn one drop, which is generally bad, but he can do Coin Animal Companion into another Animal Companion.
Yeah.
And this might be a pretty... Oh, that was a huffer.
It's kind of okay, I guess, for Kibler, though, because it gives him a reason to develop Explosive Trap, right?
Yeah, I suppose so.
Well, he can also
he's
on, Wolf Rider
he's behind
face
on board, though.
The counter.
Wolf Rider face, we're going to race. Oh, man. And then Misha comes out.
This is where you play the new Argent card that's a 2-1 charger for 3 mana.
Right.
What's it called, Trip?
The Horse Rider. The Argent Horse Rider.
Oh, that's right. Good job, Noxious.
Is it? Oh, damn.
That's a 1,000 points in today's Hearthstone draft.
Oh, yeah. Okay, so never mind this casting. We're turning this into a jet.
But I got the Wolf Rider play right. Do I get 1,000 points?
Yeah. You actually get 2,000. That was impressive.
Yeah. All right. Well, it does put on the pressure. Oh, man. I think you actually just...
Go face.
Just hit up that second animal and go face.
Yeah. That, whatever comes out, you're good to go, right? If it's Huffer, you're happy. If it's not Huffer, you're happy. So.
Yeah, I mean, it's true. Misha kind of stops the Wolf Rider. The Leoc just kind of survives. Oh, he's going for a big play here. Wow.
Explosive Trap is going to punish this somewhat. So, Kibler's not quite in the worst situation possible, but he's not in a great one either.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, man. So, I guess this Explosive Trap could be the great equalizer of this game, but it all depends also if Gar picks up another great Animal Companion on the back of that.
Yeah, he's able to do Animal Companion, Leper Gnome. That draw really kind of evens out the curve and pushes for a little bit more board, which
oh
really
my
god.
Wow.
Is this
we
how
said, we said there was no grand tournament cards, but Gara somehow snuck in the polymorph boar into his deck.
Oh, he had his own Huffer.
The Huffer to the Huffer.
What's that? Oh,
that's a Misha. What is that card? I think Huffer's disguise.
New card.
Yeah, bear disguise. You can slap it onto any spell and it'll summon a bear. True fact.
Hmm. Well, do you just push through this with Arcane Golem? I think you're at the point where you can... I mean, crossing the halfway point in the race when you're still above it is really huge. So
I like
Arcane
Golem and Blitzuka. Blitzuka gets 3 damage here.
Well, even more the next turn. 5 damage total. Yeah. At least. Maybe even more. And Kibler's in a really awkward spot. He has a lot of direct damage, but he has no board to show for it. And this is where plays like the Abusive Sergeant was more consistent than the Animal Companion for Gar, so you wanted to get that damage in now. But in this case, it's just being able to outpace Kibler because Kibler didn't have any early plays from turns 1 to 2.
I think we're maybe actually overcomplicating this a little bit. I mean, 2 Huffers just did 8 more damage than the other Animal Companions right. would have. If Kibler was at 19, this game would be even, basically.
Right, yeah. He would have been able to trade with the Huffers as they came along, and then things would have been a little less.
Kibler cannot
have a blowout.
Cannot leave the Leper Gnome on the board because it does the odd number of damage. It puts him two turns, faster on the clock. And with his opponent at 21, he has no choice but to either use Kill Command or Wolf Rider or unleash into the Leper Gnome, which basically means he's screwed.
So what he knows for a fact is that Jaime doesn't really kill the opponent either. Because even if you get it down and you get the perfect double kill command into quick shot for maximum damage output, you're still not going to win. So I think at this point he's just putting it out there on the off chance that his opponent has...
That's lethal.
...literally nothing and makes the mistake of trading.
That's unleash kill command lethal, I believe. Yeah. Or, sure.
Oh, sure.
Yeah,
you know,
really who needs a beast? Of cards, really. Between those two, three. Was able to kill it off, and that's going to wrap up the game, so that's 2-0. But more importantly, Kibler gets knocked down a peg and Gara.
Yeah.
Helping Hype climb to Master of Duels, because they have the same exact record right now.
Yeah, Hype's happy, I'm sure.
High five and Hype right now, man. It's it's evened up, and they both still have to win 2 games here, so still a lot of play.
This could be a really big series. Like for Kibler, felt like his lead was very solid about 2 weeks ago. It was like nothing moving him from the Master of Duel spot, but this might be the series that does it.
Yeah, it's not how you start, it's how you finish for sure. I want to also bring attention that I really think that winning or losing this Hunter game was also really painful too, because now it's like one of those scenarios where Kibler has to be in a position where he doesn't want to get, or like Valiant doesn't want to get in a position where they're benched, because they also have classes which can be easily targeted. Like the priest is something that you definitely don't want to have less options for. So the fact that Kibler loses here is a risk where do you play him again, play Hunter, or even send Kibler out and then risk getting benched and having Trump and Dog have to pick up the pieces here. So this is another big win for Tempo Storm, where once again, you have to be really cautious with how you proceed if you're Value Town.
Yeah. And also importantly, what do you play as a priest here? Like, what do you want to face off against as priest? I don't know what Kibler's build looks like, right? Of course, it's always up in the air. Maybe his deck is very well built to handle a Shaman. I doubt Freeze Mage is something he wants to face. I doubt Grim Patron Warrior is something he wants to face. Maybe Paladin is the closest to a decent matchup.
Can you really expect Freeze Mage? I mean, Hype brought Blinktron Mage last week.
I mean,
he was
be
confident
anything.
About it.
Right.
Yeah, this is the deck to play this week. Bam, here we go. Maybe it's still the deck to play.
Yeah, let it be
true.
We just
don't know about it. It feels like Priest is a class that kind of shines when your team's winning, and feels like it's going to struggle a lot when it's not winning.
Yeah, you can't target matchups as well.
So it's a win more class? Is that what you're saying, Krim? Because last time I checked in Hearthstone, that means it's a bad class.
Yeah, he might be able to get a decent matchup when there's very few people, very few decks that still have to win in Tempo Storm side of the board. But yeah, that's just luck of the draw, because you can't really guarantee that if Tempo Storm's last deck is like Grim Patron Warrior and you have a priest left. I mean, what do you do, right?
Well, I guess you're forced to queue it up. I mean, the priest has to win a game no matter what, but we're also ignoring the fact that Value Town has to get on the board first. And
yeah.
Priest needs to be in a position where it can get multiple chances to win. I would be very uncomfortable having Priest, like, it's tied 5-5 and Priest just gets sent out for the first time. Sure, it can definitely take the win, but it's one of those really risky gambles that they knew going into this match.
Yeah,
I do think that the best chance for the Priest to win is maybe the Paladin, though, because there are ways for you to deal with AoE if you're running more of a control variant that has Death Lords, they don't have Silence. Things that get pulled off the Death Lord isn't really that big of a threat, and you might even have Pyromancer to clear the one health minions. So
it's,
I think
just,
that might be the best chance.
Yeah, I feel it's a pretty big unknown factor. Tempest Storm does bring a lot of deck variety each week to the tournament. That could very well be like a mid range pally, which is a pretty sad matchup for a Death Lord Priest. We also don't know if it's a Death Lord Priest. Just so many questions in a class that you often need a specific matchup. I think actually Priest would be maybe a better decision against just another team. Tempo Storm just has so much unpredictability.
It's hard to get a really good matchup if you're targeting stuff like with Priest, which I guess in many ways you could say it works a bit like Freeze Mage when you've got terrible matchups, but you've also got great ones. So maybe the polarization of it is what Value Town hoped to work with, but might not work out if Tempo Storm gets ahead a bit too much. Oh, I'm not playing Control War this week. Apparently he's bringing Patron.
Yeah.
That's pretty nice.
I think he started with Control Warrior and the recent weeks has switched to Patron.
Lothe, pretty good card in this matchup. It's not necessarily recognized as one of the game-winning cards, but it is. It does a lot of work against Patron, even though you might not expect it to.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it stops a lot of the combos from happening. And sometimes just gaining that one extra turn is just enough to seal out the game. Well, that is pretty expensive Armorsmith there.
Yeah, what choice do you have, though, really?
I think, there's definitely a lot of dynamics to this matchup, which makes it really cool. People always compare Patron to Miracle, and if you think about it, if you have this Miracle matchup, you have to make sure to control the board as much as possible, too, because you really have to maximize whatever resources you get. Not to mention that you do have the Blade Flurry to clear off the patrons. Ooh. So the real threat is if your opponent can draw cards, if he can get like a cool Taskmaster Battle Rage on the Armorsmith, it can go disastrously if he ever draws a lot. So you have to be able to try and take initiative onto the board as much as possible.
What do you think about this double Fiery War Axe? Kind of like an anti-aggro tech Grim Patron deck.
Yeah, or, yeah, maybe. I don't know how much the second War Axe, like how frequently it's cut. But yeah.
I think recently it's been almost consistent.
I guess mid-range you play like two, I guess, standard. Like I think mid-range is where it starts getting really blurry, because you don't know if you want to run one or two. Yeah.
Well, Lothab seems to be like the first thing that might actually work out for Dog in the tournament today.
It's still early. It's still early. There's still possibilities for Dog.
It feels like he's just having a really rough time with this rogue deck today. Things just not working out for him. Well, this might work out. I can't really deal with the Lothab this turn, so he's... he's probably going to concede the board for a turn or two before the combo comes down.
So there's an argument, I guess, to be made for using your War Axe right now and getting the Lothab down to one. Even though you face tank five, you put her down like in an arrangement in a Whirlwind, and it allows you to redevelop that second War Axe.
Yeah, it's the only like mana efficient turn that you can do. But I think Hype's really just thinking: do I want to take that extra damage? Seeing as how desperately Dog decided to remove the Armorsmith off the board, right? So Dog seems to want to be playing a very aggressive type of game. I actually like this from Hype. Like, you don't...
Here returns a favor.
Yeah. I like the Fiery War Axe too. I know some rogue decks, not very many, but I think we've seen some that have run Harrison.
It's not uncommon, but it's not a guaranteed win either way. That's the sad part, is it still doesn't necessarily win.
You'd get a two-charge weapon with Harrison if you did have it, but you still wouldn't be all that happy because it's the Death Spite that really kills you.
Yeah. But he's running two fans of Knives, so I'm assuming he doesn't run Harrison. Usually that's kind of one of the cards that you... If you're expecting to run into maybe a metagame that has Patrons in it, you might remove the Fan of Knives. It's a very good flex spot.
Mm-hmm. I wonder if he's going to commit with the Armorsmith here. Probably not, no.
Yeah, not in the event he picks up Battle Rage, he can actually draw two more cards. Instead, he picks up Gnomish Inventor. It's important to hit these draw cards, too. That's why Shield Block has also found its way in. And of course, if you run Shield Block, two Armorsmiths, you might even opt to put it into Shield Slam. Just one, though.
Yeah.
And Patron decks have definitely started adapting a lot to the metagame, but also on the opposite end, people are starting to run a lot of cards in response to Patron, which makes it pretty interesting up to a certain point. At this stage, though, it's a little bit hard to predict what's going on because there's so many small variation lists going around out there.
I like the kill on the Lothab. It just seems in the current board state, there's no real efficiency for Dog to use any kind of spell to make use of the spell damage this turn.
Is he just pushing full face and forcing Hype to respond?
You need to be aggressive in this matchup for sure.
That's what it's looking like right now.
Mm-hmm.
Well, if you think about it, in theory, any combo deck needs time to set up. And if you can pressure them ahead of time, then you can push them out of the game potentially if they don't draw the right pieces. Plus, he already used one execute, right? So if this hypothetically landed onto the Drake, that would be a very expensive way to remove it if you have to use the Fiery War Axe. It still is, if you look at the state of the power.
I like Dog's play here. It's very like it's the only line of play that you can take that's going to perhaps guarantee a win in any circumstance, because you didn't see the execute last turn, so you've got to assume that it's not there. So by pushing this, you're expecting to keep at least four damage on the board. It's a very, very strong play.
Yeah, Hype's option is actually pretty horrible right now. Even though Hype was pretty fortunate that the Tinker Oil buff landed on the...
I think he's unfortunate. Cause
you think so?
He could have gone Warsong coined. He could have gone Warsong coined Patron, get an extra one from the 2-1, and then attack the 4-3 or the 8, the 7-3 at that point. So I think it was just a little unfortunate, but
no, you're absolutely right. You're absolutely right. He would have combo cleared the board.
Is he gonna have to do it? He has to do it anyway, right? With at least the Armorsmith or the Gnomish Inventor.
He is the Gnomish, I think. Okay.
That can't feel good. Putting out the Warsong Commander as a sacrificial lamb. And Dog with the snap kill, he's like, yep. That is not staying up.
Yeah, but at the same time, he's running out of... Well, he does have more burst damage. He's got 12 more in the hand. But Warrior still has that shield. Yeah, it's a lot, but it's not enough still.
Mm-hmm. Well, Hype is able to draw two cards and still coin armor up if he really, really needs that armor, if he feels.
Yeah.
But he does need more options. Yeah, he's just looking for something. As you mentioned, he might have like a shield slam. He might have maybe something else that might work here.
He needs to remove the antique robot or he dies because there's exact mana from Dog to pull off the deadly poison. And it doesn't look like there is.
Now the question, does Hyped coin out the armor up because he's afraid of Dog holding second Tinkers with a deadly and Blade Flurry?
No. That's three cards out of four, of course. No, he'll have 18 damage, my apologies. Right. So he won't actually
he doesn't have lethal quite.
Right. He needs Eviscerate, but he needs preparation because he doesn't have mana to do it.
Hype does it, he does armor up. And now Dog's gonna go all in and pray that the top decks are good to him.
That's how you know Hype's also an experienced rogue player. He's like, okay, well, he's holding a lot of cards.
Right.
He has to have like a certain amount of combo. What's the most he can do here?
Oh, man. And this.
The sap.
But the Harrison Jones is going to negate. Yeah.
Harrison
I was expecting,
Jones is so big.
I was expecting a Blade Flurry instead because it killed off the minion and it also dealt damage before you got weapon hated. The thing is, how many patron decks do you really expect to play Harrison Jones, right? Like, it's not a guaranteed tech in any case.
Oh, still no good. I think you'd consider battle raging here, perhaps. No, it's
battle rage and find a whirlwind execute. Otherwise, you're just armor up. I think you have to battle rage anyway.
Or inner rage.
Right?
It's inner rage or whirlwind. He's drawn a lot of cards. You have to consider that.
Mm-hmm. Well, let's see if the outs. Oh,
there it is.
Fix it up. And down goes Dog. Well, not quite.
Yet.
But...
Not yet.
Yeah, he still has sprint.
Yeah, this,
I mean, that's the only way to answer that.
This is a game. I think actually he has maybe two tries to draw sprint. Oh,
he
gets it immediately.
Picks it up. You know, just easy life. Oh my goodness,
wow.
That damage.
I think I like the SI face here.
Yeah, I think it's right. I think it's right, Crib. We got a smork it. This is a good spot because you can dagger up and then attack phase, Blade Flurry, double Ivis, and you've got him dead.
Yeah, he's used both armor smiths, and he's also used a shield block. So his life gain mechanisms are pretty much
gone. Yeah.
And then Hyped plays the patron with the heal bot.
Yeah, plot or, you twist. Know, maybe it's like a throwback.
It could
with
be.
Like
there could be, like, just another shield block, though. Like, that's not that unlikely.
Mm-hmm. We've seen a lot of that, actually, in the past few weeks. Mm-hmm. Come on, Dog. SI the face. What's the worst that could happen? Oh, man, he doesn't. He still gets it done next turn, anyway.
Right. Like, I think he doesn't want to alarm suspicion, because if you SI the face, I think that's a little too obvious of what's going to happen.
I like that idea, yeah. We were looking at the math of it, not the psychology, Froden. You're way too deep for us in this this case.
I don't know how much psychology there is. Like, if you're hyped, you saw a rogue sprint, you're at 8 life, you know something bad's about to happen next turn. I don't know if psychology really is a dominant factor here.
Well, you can draw 2 cards off Battle Rage, maybe pick up that second shield block we were speaking about. You know, if he does include 2, then I think that's a really good play. Nope, not what he was looking for, that's for sure.
It's not too bad, though. I mean, I don't even know if he's dead. Like, is he dead? He's not dead. If he
SI double Ivis is GG,
He's dead.
No matter what.
Oh, through the taunt, that's right. Yeah.
The direct damage is too much to stop, unless Hype's willing to dig even deeper and try to stay alive here, but most likely he'll just set up a defensive play. With the unstable ghoul.
Plays around South Sea number 2, if that's even in there, which you probably assume is not, but Dog has exactly what he needs to finish off.
Yeah, he's got one over lethal here.
There it is. So you know, one good draw warrants another. And even though Hype was able to remove that antique heal bot and seemed to stay alive, Rogue able to keep that pressure. And I think you can go ahead and retrace a lot of steps that I really liked from Dog this game. Killing off the Armorsmith with, you know, quick precision instead of just fanning of, fan of knives and just trying to draw through. Being able to deal with all that really aggressively limits Hype's options a lot in order to reduce the pressure and stay alive.
Yeah.
That's true, that's true.
Those are crazy Whirlwind top deck, but there's also crazy Sprint top deck. So they kind of top decked each other back
then. I don't know. I think the Warrior draws like way more cards throughout the game, and the Warrior had a lot more answers than just Sprint to draw.
All right.
If there was like an RNG award for that game, I think Dog would take it. But both players kind of got out of their bad spots with their draws that game. It's just Dog's was certainly much more significant. Like, you can't really chip away at a Warrior if you're out of steam. So Dog kind of had that turn or maybe the next to draw Sprint. But the Sprint also had to be really good, which it was.
Yeah, you're right. Actually, gave him like all the cards he needed in the world. So
yeah.
Oh, well.
I wonder how relieved Kibler is to see that Dog beat Hyped, because now the Master of Duels title is still up for grabs. I actually hope that this comes down to a Hyped versus Kibler showdown.
Yeah, we were talking about that last week. I was really Hyped was saying, you know, this might just be a 1v1. You know, everybody's gone, everybody's done what they had to, and it's down to Kibler versus me. That'd be crazy.
I really feel like that Priest deck has an extremely high opportunity to sink Kibler a little bit.
Okay.
Yeah, it depends, because if it ever comes down to that point, I think the Priest is a liability against Hype's classes, especially if he's bringing Freeze Mage and not Mech Mage or Blink Drum Mage or whatever he's bringing today.
Mm-hmm.
That's also the big X factor of what Hype's Mage is today.
Yeah. It could go, like, that's the thing, like, the Priest could go full Titanic and do nothing.
Full Titanic, oh man.
Yeah, you don't want to.
It's just a really big problem. It's typical, I think Priest in tournaments have shown in the past that you bring it because it's almost novel, and you expect to take people off guard, but aside from Kalento, right? And I don't think it matters, you know, when you say, when there's an exception and Kalento is the one who's mentioned, it doesn't apply to everyone else. Kalento is the only person I've seen in tournaments just power through with Priest, which hasn't really been the case of anyone else.
I don't really know if it's that. I think Priest just kind of fits a role in the best of five conquest format, where you bring three anti-aggro decks, and players who bring any aggro decks just can't win against you very well. In a format where it's best of 11, you just can't. Like, you have to kind of get lucky.
I see what you mean. You can't target the matchups as readily as in a best of five. That's a great point.
Yeah, so, like, Priest, I think, sees some tournament play just because of that. I think on one hand, people just run, like, three aggressive decks or run, like, three anti-aggressive decks. And if you run the three anti-aggressive decks, Priest has a role in your lineup.
All right, well, looks like we're going into Patron Warrior Mirrors. Trump makes his first appearance of the day. And Hyped starts off with a Thorsen and the coin in hand, so that gives him a lot of explosive possibilities. A lot of times this matchup, you can be having, the opponent could be drawing an insane amount of cards. You can have 10 cards and you can have four, but if those four cards get you a Patron Flood, sometimes that wins you the game. So this matchup is never truly over. We've also seen people go for like lethals, rope out, and then be a few points off, and then your opponent then counter lethals you because...
Right. They use frothing, you use Patron, so you lost it.
So yeah, this matchup is really funny sometimes to watch that, if you think about it that way.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I'm disappointed Zelay is not playing this, because I'm sure we'd see a great game. Pure lethal miss.
Too soon.
Actually, Zelay has been kind of killing it on Patron Warrior in the last few weeks, hasn't he? I think it was the first 3 weeks where that happened. It's just that it was kind of funny that it happened like twice in this tournament and once in another tournament, and it was all like back to back to back almost.
Yeah.
But again, you can't really blame players for those type of situations with the deck.
What do you think about the Acolyte being thrown on the board here? Like, sorry to interrupt, because this is a really unusual play from one, from my perspective, but maybe I'm not looking at this right.
I think the interesting play is I jumped in armor up on turn two. He specifically passed because he had his battle rage in hand, so he wants to draw cards. And I know a lot of people always debate this. Like, for example, the Rat hit number one legend on NA multiple times with the Patron deck when it first came out. And he was saying, you don't armor up in the mirror because you want to draw cards. And it's just very interesting dynamic to see Trump go through with that, considering that, you know, most people don't do that. Very fast.
Here we go. The Patron Vomit is about to start next turn from Trump's side.
Yeah. That's gonna happen, but what do you do if you're hype here?
You don't play the Unstable Ghoul. No.
No, you don't.
I'm not sure about the follow-up.
I actually don't know if you play much of anything.
Yeah. There's no play I like from hype side. Maybe play the War Axe to set up a way for you to kill one of the patrons that might come out if that happens, since he's got a, you know, Deathbite ready to proc.
I think a lot of these decks do run Harrison, but again, yeah, you're okay if your Fiery War Axe gets Harrisoned. It's just, I think you still don't want to give him two cards. Like, if it's against a rogue, giving him two cards just is fine. But against another Grim Patron Warrior, giving him two cards is really devastating. So I think if you play the Axe, I think you might need to attack. Nope.
My mistake, by the way, guys. I thought Trump was the one holding Thorsten, but...
No, was that was,
so
that
it was the other way around. Hyped. So Hyped was
they're
the one
both,
who held
They're both holding horse, Thorsten now.
Oh, yeah.
Right. Froden's commentary is suddenly irrelevant. Right.
There he is. You two can handle from his song, right?
Okay, I'm out.
I can just peace out. Cool.
All right, well, everyone can get in here right now. It's just whether Trump allows this action to happen.
Would you do that? Like, because I haven't really seen any way for the Warrior players otherwise to really deal with a board like this. It seems to be the case that really they feel like druids when somebody just plays a lot of patrons, where everything you do kind of feels like the swipe left over, where every removal you've got just fuels even more patrons.
Yeah, I think that you definitely go for it. This is the game-winning play. There's no way Hype can come back from this type of early game board that quickly, unless he's doing like what Savitz used to do, which is like run a brawl because mm-hmm. of the mirror, and that'll help you win. But this is a board full of patrons. That's six patrons on the board now.
Yeah.
And Hype's...
kind of need double execute in this
situation. Sweating it out.
And even then, in this case, it doesn't do anything. It's all about the brawl.
This is where Hype needs like a Deathbite and a Frothing, right?
Actually, is it really over? Because there's the Emperor Thoris in play that forces the opponent to kill it, for one, and then you have your own Warsong Commander Patron Whirlwind turn, for all that's worth.
It's not. Is it worth that much, there's though?
There's no way he can actually... I mean, that's
like
the problem
every,
we're running
every
into.
Every multiplier effect on your patron multiplies your opponent's patrons, too, so you can't really get ahead. I think the only danger from Trump is that when you play a bunch of patrons, your opponent might have a Frothing, and he might just have, like, endless activators.
Yeah. With Aster Thorsten.
Yeah. It's, in fact, Trump who has the...
That's a good card, right? Do you have a second execute on the back end?
Yeah. Trump's the one with the charging Frothing, perhaps. Actually, if Hype tries to make a push for the board here, I think he's going to die.
Yeah.
But I think he might have to. Like, right now, he's dying anyway.
So is there a way to force the patrons to be too numerous to copy themselves? No, that's happened before, where if the board is capped, then the patrons don't copy, and then you can waste some activators on them. I don't think there's enough Whirlwind effects in the first place to try that out, right? So you'd go Warsong, Grim Patron, Ghoul, then attack the 3-2, and then go for the Whirlwind, and you can probably clear the board with that. I'm pretty sure you can clear, but I couldn't swear it.
No guarantees.
But I get the feeling he can't. He's got two whirlwind effects for his own duplication, and he's capping the opponent's board. I think he can.
I think whatever Hype does to maybe even clear, I kind of doubt that he can. I don't really see it.
Right.
But even if he like goes with that line of play, I feel like Trump's gonna be okay.
Well, yeah, he's gonna have the edge pretty much no matter what. But I think this is the play that he needs to do. But now he's on the ropes. I don't think that's gonna work out either way.
Yeah, Hype's running out of time. There's no way he can actually do this just like physically, because there's just not enough seconds on the board for him.
Unless there's a delay in the spectator mode, but I doubt it.
Nah, there's no way.
Because from my perspective, he could then attack that 3-2 over there, spawn another patron, the whirlwind for 6, he would have enough patrons that... Anyway.
Yeah, so what we don't really necessarily account for is like attacking into that patron, like you were saying, Noxious, actually spawns another patron in itself and then multiplies by itself. It's just, you don't...
It's just...
You can't get
too,
back.
Too many patrons getting in here.
He needs a chill maw.
That's like, welcome to hell. Oh man, Chilma. And then yeah. Patron's gonna tech an owl, and then you go nowhere.
Actually, would revenge have been enough?
He was 13.
At like, he was
yeah,
at like
right.
13 or something. So if he had revenge, he could have just wiped up the patron party.
And some players do in fact play revenge. You know, we've seen it on ladder infrequently, mind you, but it's been played.
That's what he needed. But instead, he's 2 losses for the day. And he's benched. Look at that.
That's right. And I think it's very unlikely that Kibler will get benched either. So I think this is a really good spot for
Valiant. It's time for Priest.
Yeah. And time has come to get the Freeze Mage out of the way, get the Patron out of the way, queue into Shaman. Maybe your deck is well built. And Kibler is definitely going to jump on this opportunity there. And the worst part is maybe if Kibler wins, in this case, Hyped is still benched. So they're going to be able to target the Shaman and Pally for as long as they want.
Yeah. I feel like putting up Hype was such a big risk. And I don't know if the payout was like big enough.
Yeah, but I feel like there's really nothing... I feel like nothing Hype could do that game because Trump had the play that we were talking about. If you just flood the board with patrons, there's really nothing you can do outside of...
Frothing OTK, yeah.
Yeah, like being able to reverse kill him somehow. And that's really unlikely. And I just feel like there's no reason to necessarily be like, Hype sucks, like I can't believe he went 0-2. I feel like in this case, Trump just knew his win condition and was able to play to it. Now, it's like you said, I think Priest absolutely should come out here from Kibler. And then it basically comes out to what Tempo Storm feels like is the best matchup against Priest, if any.
Mm-hmm. The thing is, like, Priest has teched so much against anti-aggro these days that, like, Gar is capable of bringing a control Shaman. And I'm not even sure if Priest is still favored against the control Shaman with all the tech it has against anti-aggro.
Yeah, it's really interesting to think about, right? Like, if mid-range Shaman, like, how that matchup has evolved. Well, we're not even going to see that. We're going to see the Paladin coming out here from Eloise.
Interesting.
And I guess this is the best choice based off sheer power level, I guess, because if... I'm guessing this is aggro Paladin, because I'd be really surprised if a mid-range Paladin came out against Priest when you expect
it. Yeah. Well, mid-range and aggro is not very good against Priest, I think. But I think control Pally does really well, especially because of that, especially because Priest is so teched against anti-aggro that it's still slow enough that the big threats make it. They play a Deathlord, you know, you'd be quality and you'd get out like a Doctor Boom or a Tyrion and then stuff just is completely one-sided.
Yeah, it used to be the case that Control Priest was basically running all over Paladin because they just stole the threats and handled them one at a time. But now that the decks are all, as you said, you know, teched anti-aggro, then it makes for a very different lineup. And it looks like an aggro Pally from Eloise, right? And Kibler, pretty good start.
This is dream start. I'm with Frodo on this one. This is better than a pretty good start, I think, if you're the Priest.
Yeah, yeah. If he gets Valence chosen, I think that's pretty much it, unless Eloise is able to get some way to deal with that, like Silence or some way that Kibler just keeps drawing dead after that. But I don't really feel like that's going to happen here.
Yeah, she's going to try to remove it off the board and hope there's no powered shield, but Kibler just has two choices, get another minion out or get the powered shield.
The Shrinkmeister is the better play because next turn you want a powered shield and heal.
Yeah, no, it's going to be insane. It's going to be a completely insane follow-up for Kibler.
Oh, man. No, man.
That's it. Like, no, that's it.
We did that last time, Kriv. You know how that went down? It was a match we thought was completely lost, and then it turned around somewhere in mid-game. So.
Let's see.
No.
The weapon could change things a bit. Right? No. But the thing is, okay, so here's the question. Like, even if Eloise ends up wiping the board, if that happens, how does she win? Because that's still a question left to be answered, right? Even if you clear the board and you stabilize, like, top deck in your way to the end game is not a way to win.
Her main win condition right now is for Kibler to ignore the Squire and for her to get a Blessing of Kings while the Divine Shield is still active. That's the win condition right now.
I think Kibler will make that mistake, though.
Well, he hasn't drawn turn 4 play yet.
Oh, wow.
Maybe this gives an opportunity to fight back. That's pretty good draw.
That is a really good draw. The King's line of play isn't as likely, but yeah. Okay, fine.
There we go, Chris. We're forced to do that every year.
No, I think it's still really unlikely because he's got the Light Bomb, he's got two Sludge Belchers.
And the Cabal, so...
Yeah. Like, the problem with Priest is, like, you're always in a pretty good situation. After like turn 5 or 6, but you're usually really low on life. The fact that Kibler had an incredible start makes it so he's starting the game at full health, and that makes it so hard for the Paladin to actually do anything throughout the game.
Yeah, so you basically try to get, 15 damage in without the Priest being able to interact with you, and then when he starts being able to interact, you lose the board, sure, but you've got a lot less damage to get in.
All right, well, this is the True Silver play. Most likely, we'll see a True Silver hit into Juggler, Muster for Battle next turn.
Yeah, you have to deal with the Zombie Chow, but now it's just going to be really difficult because now you've given Priest so much time to set up. Oh, man.
It's getting worse.
It's like the fact that Kibler is going to not die, period.
The thing is, though, because Kibler drew so badly... it does bring Eloise a chance with a Divine Favor draw. As it was looking on like turn 3 or 4, it seemed like Eloise is also having more cards in her hand than the Priest, which makes it so it's completely hopeless. But now with like poor draws from Kibler, there is some hope with Divine Favor.
Yeah, the fact is Kibler, I think he has like 3 of the most expensive cards in his deck. If he does run something later, I'd be surprised if it was anything like Mind Control might be in the deck, but like other than that, it's pretty much those 6 mana cards, and he was maybe picking up other things. Yeah, maybe.
Move quickly. Well, Eloise is trying to consider what's the line of play that wins the game, and maybe going full Smork is not exactly the best way to go. You'd have to at least kill the Belcher, but there's a second one coming up. You know, that's the worst case scenario. Even more removal from the Priest. Eloise can't feel good about this. Like, I can't imagine she thinks this is gonna stick to the board.
I think I like Sylvanas here.
Well, what about Nova Chow? Actually, Cabal is better for later. Belcher Chow works too, I guess. Yeah, it works super well.
Stops the damage.
Mm-hmm. Which damage?
Well, it's none now.
Right. That's a really convincing win, though, from Kibler. That's probably the best possible outcome. So the Priest is not going to go Titanic mode on this, and he's going to actually probably grab a win, depending on how Eloise's follow-up is. Because really, Blessing of Kings is probably the only hope that I can see here. And then Kibler has to whiff.
I think the hope is just like 3 juggles into... Oh my god. Almost.
Yeah, almost got it.
You still kill the Sludge Belcher. So...
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Not bad.
It's looking good for Eloise.
Not really.
Yeah. Well, in this scenario, there's a second light bomb. In this scenario, though, even if Kibler didn't have that Holy Nova, it's one of those positions where he has so much ways to just impact the board. There's nothing you can do. And I think this is a case where, like, Priest just draws into an unlosable hand versus aggro, generally speaking. Yeah. Sure, he missed one turn of playing something onto the board, but it was mitigated by the fact that it turns 1-3, he had dominant board position.
Yeah. Well, I mean, it'll happen once in a while, and well, it's good for Kibler, I guess, bringing the Priest and getting a good success.
Look at the head.
So,
look at the head right now.
You don't like the Hero it's Power so Argent Protector?
No, the play is, yeah, it's Hero Power, Blessing of Might, and Argent Protector on the dude. You know, 4-1 Divine Shield. It stands up to the board and stuff, I guess. But
like, Kibler could have a hand. Like, his entire deck right now could consist of nothing but Silverback Patriarch, and he'd still be fine.
Actually, I think that's the play, and you have to use the weapon on the Zombie Child to bring it to a 2-2.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, Force the Priest to preemptively heal it, and then the other charge next turn could take care of it anyway. Do you think Kibler will go for the light bomb play?
Hmm.
Just because he can, of course, right? Not because it's necessary, because really it isn't. He can even, yeah.
Yeah, he also has Cabal to just take the 2-2. And his opponent's out of cards, essentially. The only thing that he has to be worried about is if Eloise ends up drawing Divine Favor. But even then, it's one of those things where Divine Favor is usually the reach, so that way you can, you know, vomit your hand and then hit the face and then refill and then have it go across the finish line. Because usually the first hand of Aggro Paladin isn't what wins you the game. It's the refill that has just enough juice to get it over.
And Kibler's a 28.
Yeah, yeah. You know, he's not remotely... I don't think Eloise assumes she's going to win this, but... Kibler's taking a sweet time trying to optimize the decisions, at least. I mean, Divine Favor could still help. But...
And I mean, you know, Battle.net could go down.
Yeah, I mean, Kibler's house could burn.
Yeah, I don't know about that one.
If enough people are trying to log on to play the Grand Tournament Brawl, then maybe.
We have to remake the match. Oh, man.
That's almost
well, it's not
the best
really a bad
here.
Target to the...
Oh, wow.
Goodness, that's a board clear.
That's a crazy top deck.
Yes, it is.
It's great. It's going to put the Priest on 28.
Okay, but then Kibler just does the same, but even better. He has the ability to clear the board with Light Bomb in the future, but he also has Dark Cultist and Sylvanas.
You still have to take the play, right? As bad as it looks.
Yeah, of course.
Well, like, there's nothing else.
That's the first play that looks good from the Paladin the entire game.
That's cruel.
You just Hero Power, or do you play Defender for tempo?
No, yep, Hero Power. Defender's bad because like Priest from Death sometimes.
Oh, I think Shadow Madness is also
a consideration. Oh, yeah.
That's pretty well. Shadow Madness hits anyway. But it's less devastating because you still have the Argus.
Right.
Oh man, Kibler is full on anti aggro. This deck is insanely anti aggro deck.
So, rightfully so. You expect a handful of aggro decks. Priest is one of the better decks at dealing with aggro, but it's always conditional. It's like, well, if you can have things line up the way you want it to, then yes.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, like Zombie Chat powered shield. You know, that's a pretty good start.
No. Okay.
Second Light Bomb wipes it out, and then you can buff the Senjin. Or if you want to heal and get more mileage, but I like dumping the hand because, again, Divine Favor gets less value.
Yeah, exactly.
Now there's only two cards.
Kibler also had the option to play Velens and then Light Bomb.
And loses.
That would have cleared the board.
Yeah, he would have kept his Cultist. I'm surprised he didn't do that because. He could have actually wiped the board with that play and kept the Cultist alive.
Yeah, that's a little bit of a slip-up, but it really makes no difference here.
Mm-hmm.
If he had done the other play, he would have pushed for 5 more face damage, and the Cultist would have had another health point.
Yeah, would have still died at True Silver.
Yeah.
It's kind of amusing. I think this is the first turn that Eloise has like board control. No, that's the second turn because she also
She looks bored. Oh, you mean board control? Okay. I have no
time for. Well, I was just kind of like thinking that
that one
surprisingly
one
priest
control.
Has no cards, right?
Yeah.
Even though that's what he gravitates towards. It's funny because this True Silver gets value. It kills two cards.
Yeah.
And now Priest is on a situation where it kind of wants to draw cards because what if it can't close up the game and then Paladin...
You don't want to draw cards right now. Like, the only really bad thing that could happen is you would draw, like, five cards or something, and then the Paladin would draw Divine Favor and would draw a second Divine Favor from the first Divine Favor. Which has actually happened more times than you can imagine. Happen all the time.
Yeah, well, that's kind of what Aggro Pally does. It steals games on its own. And now Kibler is still forced in a position of having to deal with those 2/1s, which is crazy pressure. Oh, never mind.
Nice draw. That's a really
gimme,
nice
gimme.
Let me change your okay. mind. Now, does he want
to? This is very.
Oh
music
no,
me.
He's drawn
MC
a card.
Tech.
Okay.
What if MC
now
Tech
there
happens?
Is a possibility. I don't think it. I don't think she is.
Oh my god.
Okay,
this is
but that's also the beginning of the end. Anyways, she can't really deal with it, and this also signifies that she probably's not playing quality.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah,
because
definitely,
you know, some of these aggro paladin decks they play a quality and they have the consecration as a comeback mechanism, which seems counterintuitive because like why would you care about board clear if you're aggro? But some of them do run it, so be careful.
What
a
turn of events, though! Like, we Tumblestone was up 2-0 against Valuetown. And in that situation, you know, all we could talk about was how terrible the priest would be. But
right,
priest wins.
Yeah, hype goes in with the high risk matchups, and he doesn't get very lucky. He ends up losing the game, gives Valuetown a ridiculously good opportunity to play the priest. Mm-hmm. The priest is basically the worst nightmare Tempestorm could have had for in that situation. And I mean, now what, right? Like, if
he's still
if Hype,
benched,
yeah. If Hype is still benched and he is, I think we still have like pretty good matchups here from some of the other decks. Perhaps, doesn't Zulok do pretty well against the Aggro Shaman and Aggro Pally?
I'd assume
it's
so.
Just like it's the same type of gameplay, but it's stickier minions, right?
And right. Also maybe like higher, like more consistency because of the hero power, I guess, in many cases. So,
I think Trump has brought a lot of Handlock early on in the tournament, but I think last week he did bring a Zoo deck. So if it is Zoo, again, Valuetown has a really, really good matchup.
Yeah, I would like Trump to bring out the Warlock here. And I wouldn't be hard-pressed to that if Dog tossed out... Freeze Mage eventually, because again he doesn't want to necessarily hit against the warrior class. Although I guess people are already turning their opinions, right? People are saying that Freeze Mage is not as bad against Patron Warrior as it is, but I still think Freeze Mage is one of the best at handling aggro. So mm-hmm. Dog tosses it out here. At the same time, we don't know if it's Freeze Mage.
Well, Dog's I don't really like. Dog has played, I think, once. He brought a Tempo Mage deck, but you know, as you mentioned, it's one of the decks that you pin him on the most is probably Freeze Mage. He's played it, you know, so much so that I'd be very surprised, but with anything else. But you never know. I mean, it's tournament settings. People might try to switch up their game a little, take their opponents off guard. So definitely a possibility.
All right, and here we are. It looks like it is going to be a Freeze Mage.
Yeah, so this is an interesting dynamic because Freeze Mage is one of the best at handling aggro, but it's also a deck that draws an insane amount, and Divine Favor gets really big value. So sometimes what happens is Freeze Mage draws a lot of cards, it gets up the ice barriers, but your opponent draws a ton of cards anyways. And
right.
Not only does your freeze, like, it kills everything, but there's chargers that come out, so it doesn't really matter if you freeze the board unless they have 7 minions on it.
Mm. Ooh, that's a pretty... It's a pretty good start.
Yeah.
It's okay. Consecration doesn't really do much. This matchup's just like...
two damage to face. Yeah, or kill a mad scientist, I guess. Like, it forces you not to have to deal with the trade. You just force the mage to ping the 1-1 or whatever.
Hmm.
Oh, the preemptive doomsayer or the
coin really, ping? I'm really curious, like, the squire versus the leper gnome in this situation.
So you'd like to force the mage to basically have to deal with three minions at the same time, and then... I mean, you're not going to get coin pinged for sure if you play Arden Squire. What's the risk of running two leper gnomes?
If you just let the mage have their mana crystals, have their options, it's impossible to win.
Oh, that's a bit of an awkward top deck for Dog. He's got two turns to go before Blizzard is actually useful. So in the meantime, Eloise could pack up, I don't know, Blessing of Kings, assuming she top decks it. From his perspective, it's looking very dangerous, and you might have to end up dealing with like a 1-1 that gets buffed. And you don't want to use your prime removal on that.
Yeah, one dynamic.
Oh,
that
calculating we lethal already? That's great.
12,
yeah, he's got Alex, so
29 damage of burn, but he has to get to turn 10. Yeah, he can do that. Well, one thing that is also interesting to call into notion is that usually the mage is super dependent on secrets in order to be able to handle the aggro, because you have things like Ice Spirit to give you 8 health. They're like heal bots. Or you have the ice block to guarantee you another turn, so you can even go aggressive and combo your opponent down. And if Dodd doesn't draw any of his secrets or his mad scientists, do you think he can pull out this game? It's going to be really tough.
Well, it's all about getting like enough AoE could do it as well, right?
I guess so, but there's a lot of damage that just comes from the...
That's a good card against Freeze Mage.
Yeah, it is.
And then Shockadon includes Ragnaros, and Freeze Mage goes down. The nightmare.
I'm actually really surprised on the Ice Lance play against the dude.
He just wants to save health as much as possible.
So he's keeping Frostbolt for something more meaningful? He needs a Nova right now, at least. Oh, man.
I mean, that's something to do, but it's also really bad considering what your opponent can have Divine Favor. So again, this deck is really good and adept at taking out aggro, but it's also good at putting itself in an awkward spot against the deck.
I think the Acolyte is fine. I don't think you care that much about Divine Favor at this point in the game, just because your tools start to become quite relevant at the higher mana crystals. I think you just play the Acolyte because it's likely to absorb at least a 4 damage hit from a True Silver.
Or 3 damage into Divine Favor. But then you're still probably going to win unless the opponent gets like Arcane Golem with double Blessing of Might.
What if you play Acolyte and like Frostbolt face here?
Well, that's a good prospect.
Then Dog just has like super hacker instincts. It's like the fact that he thinks his opponent has a weapon right there. I think pinging the...
Well, no, it's just... if your opponent did have Divine Favor, they could make you overdraw and then
Divine
Favor you. Wow. Okay. Is this the same deck?
Well, it has Leper Gnome's Crypt, so we know it has to. I'm thinking maybe Eloise took out the Chargers and put some real big late game. And now it's interesting because what if she drew this against like the Priest and it didn't the priest didn't happen to have like some of the responses to it because it didn't have Shadow Word Death and whatnot.
It had Sylvanas.
The Light Bomb was fine.
Oh, you're right. The Sylvanas. Yeah. Sylvanas was key.
Well, Dog finally finds the first secret, so that's going to be useful. But due to Dr. Boom on the board, he's going to have to slow it down a bit. He's going to have to at least consider the Fireball Ping. Oh my goodness.
Yikes.
No, how tempting.
You have to play Dr. Boom.
Yeah, you're getting this anyway.
The worst thing that could happen to Dr. Boom is like a two-card combo. So you're really only drawing one card less with Divine Favor, but you're applying so much pressure on Mage at 14 life and no secrets.
Mm-hmm. Would you Frostbolt the Dr. Boom?
Yes.
Because you really want to get that secret out?
Yes.
Yeah. Yes, okay. Got it.
Yeah, it's a good point to make because some people might be like, oh, Ice Barrier cancels out the turn, so maybe I have more time, but no, you want to generally go as hard as possible. Now, Eloise has a couple of options here, but I like still going for the big tempo play or like the pressure play. I think if you just drop Tyrion, attack the weapon, you know, let whatever secret it
yeah.
be,
then go. I think it's most important face.
Yeah, more importantly, you have to trigger the Ice Barrier because you don't want Ice Block as a possibility here. Or do you want Ice Block?
Yeah, I think you do want Ice Block. I think this is where you really have to think about the options. So, like, if it's Ice Barrier, the play is, like, good enough, I think, like what you suggested. But if it's Ice Block, it makes it so the Boombots threaten lethal if Dog's
on their own. Right.
Well,
it might depend on whether or not
you get him down to, like, 6 health first, if you can. But it's a really good point. Now that I think about it, I think you're right. And now it's like this position where Dog gets a little bit less time, assuming that Eloise can survive to that point. Because one of the tricky
Actually,
things, too,
is Dog Alex just Stronza. Guaranteed to win? Yeah. Right. I was going to ask.
No. Not yet.
It's not guaranteed, but it's tricky.
Yeah.
It's because like, he can't get like pressured out of this game, so he's got to use some of this burn on the minions. And Alistraza is not enough because he's had to use so much of this burn on the minions.
Well, he has 16 damage. So the key is, can he keep his Ice Block up
long enough
when Alistraza comes down? Which the answer should be yes. So then the follow-up question is, can he survive the following turn? He needs a second Ice Block or some way to guarantee it.
Yeah.
And Eloise is really scared because it's like, here's also an awkward spot. I think you want to heal with the True Silver Champion. So at the same time, though, when you play Tyrion, generally speaking, you want to attack at the weapon so you can maximize your damage.
I think she's seeing if she can proc in the block as soon as possible here.
The Kings is definitely a great play, just because the Boombot becomes a super big threat, and then if he pops it, then... if he kills the Boombot, he's opening himself up to...
Exactly. That's kind of the line of play where you push for a lot of damage and you have a threatening Boombot.
Yeah. Well, she seems like she's looking to play Tyrion as soon as possible, which means she's probably going to use the True Summer Charge right now. Oh, that was a good hit. Great hit there. Dog is... Dog had the exact reaction we did. Whoa.
Yeah, so now it's going to be if Dog can draw a second Ice Block or a way to survive one more turn post Alistraza. He has to go
for Alex
he draws
Jim
a
Ice
Block.
Crazy.
Game. There's no way for Eloise to win unless she has Kazan Mystic.
Let it be real.
Yeah, now the alternative, was there an opportunity to... No. Okay, I was thinking if she kept True Silver Champion and was able to heal too and drew a second True Silver Champion, but
she
I'm
would
not
have,
sure
yeah.
if that would... enough.
That would have been enough, I think, by like 2 damage. Yeah. I think it would have been like a tiny amount more.
But you can't power ping. Boss ping anymore.
Yeah. Yeah, Frodan, we're way out of beta.
My bad. I was just counting damage and then weaving and ping every turn. So.
Oh, man. So I guess you're trying to maximize your your clear here.
Now she has to, in Eloise's mind, she has to pop the ice block while guaranteeing that she won't die to an Alistraza, like, clearing the board type thing and then pushing the damage that way. Because you have to account for the fact that Alistraza might be additional burn damage, assuming the Dog doesn't have that damage.
Yeah. She's gonna go for a Kings on the Tyrion defensively, I think.
Yeah, it makes the most sense. But it's not completely over, because there is one more draw, and I'd be really surprised if it was Kazan Mystic, but that is...
I think she has some of these late game threats. I think there's a realistic chance that there's a Lotheb in this deck.
Oh, wow.
No.
Nope.
I mean, there's not even really a way to...
She's gonna try, right? Like, you never know if there's no Pyroblast.
Yeah. I'm just thinking about if there's anything else that she could be worried about playing around, but in this case, she's like, well, he's used two Fireball, so I think I should have that.
And Value Town is on a roll after that initial rough start.
Four in a row.
Crazy.
Wait, this also means that Eloise is benched, by the way.
Oh my god, you have got to be kidding. It's going to be Shaman versus Warlock and Hunter?
It's Shaman versus the world.
I would rather not.
Think of all the pressure that Gar is on here with what's probably going to be a fairly or maybe even extremely inconsistent deck.
Yep.
This is a possible reverse sweep, and not like a small one from, you know, two people equalizing at 2-2 or two teams. Literally six straight wins.
Yeah.
That would just be completely possible.
It is, and then...
Let's take a look at the classes again. It's Trump on Warlock and Kibler on Hunter. And both of these are pretty decent against just the general Shaman list.
Yeah.
Yeah, I think so.
That's a really rough one.
I don't even know what to say. Like
the Paladin can... Or it's not the Paladin. The Shaman can definitely outrace the Hunter sometimes. What gets really difficult is that Shaman... The mech Shaman nowadays have a really hard time fighting back for board even more than they did before because they're so face-oriented. Some of the recent mech Shaman lists run two Doomhammers, for example. Mm-hmm. And if you're running two Doomhammers, it's because you're trying to just go really aggressive and hit your opponent. But if you're using Doomhammer and have to clean up, you're just going to lose completely, especially to an aggressive deck. So I'm not feeling very confident about the Shaman, but also, the Shaman is probably the most explosive deck in the entire game because you have two Lava Bursts, two Doomhammers, Rockbiters. You know, you have the Whirling Zap-O-Matic. So some of the explosive damage is insane. You can lose by turn 4 or 5, and I there's only a handful of decks that can do that.
Yeah.
Yeah. What I'm really curious about is why we see so few Fel Reavers in Shaman. And I think that, like, we talk about how Shaman can race a Hunter. I think traditionally it's been that card that allows it to happen.
That's a great point, but I think as Hybrid becomes more and more impactful, maybe the Hunter is able to trade with your earlier board, and then Felreaver runs into Freezing Trap, so that's an issue. It really depends on what you're expecting to face, and I think the reason Felreaver was phased out was largely because, number one, they had the Fire Guard Destroy as a decent alternative, and even on turns where they could play Felreaver sometimes against the control-heavy meta, they decided not to because Execute and Patron was everywhere, and then they had the BGH as well and some of the other slower lists.
All right. They actually buffed Felreaver in this patch, you know that? It doesn't...
doesn't show anything, right?
It doesn't show what cards you remove from your deck.
And then you don't cry when you don't find the card you wanted, right? Like, I think it's good for you, too. Mentally, it keeps you sane.
I think it shows you what you lost, I'm pretty sure.
Oh, does it?
Yeah, it does. Okay. It doesn't show your opponent, though, which can be really relevant.
It can.
Especially because as they find out more information, it's not necessarily the first few cards that get burned. It's always, like, the last few cards that get burned that's, like, the most painful when you see
favorite discards. I don't think it's about showing what's in the deck. It's showing, like, you know, you play something into an onboard Felreaver and you see, like, crackle, crackle, lava burst, lava burst. You're like, okay, I'm not dying.
Yeah,
but if you don't see the cards go by, you'll be playing around Crackle and Lava Burst for the rest of the game.
Yep. Two Lava Bursts in the hand for Gaara. That's pretty indicative that he's just going to have to go super aggressive.
Right off the bat.
Face is the place.
It's always the place, Crit.
Yeah, but I don't know if he'll Lava Burst immediately on turn 3. I think he's going to see if he draws anything. If not, then probably Totem. Really stinks, but in Kibler land he has the two Glaive Zookas, so he's got ways to deal with this Zap-O-Matic, which is very important.
Kibler Land. Man, that sounds like a fun place to be right now.
It is. There's a lot of dragons and dogs.
All right.
Dragons and dogs, okay.
Well, actually, I don't even... Well, he basically, Kibler is obsessed with his dog, Shiro. I think I read one of his social media plugs the other day where it was like, he was with a financial advisor, and they asked, what are some of your goals? And he says, I want to be rich enough where I can take my dog wherever I want in the world. And they can't say no.
Who to shoot? This is, that's an ambition.
Okay. I promise you that I don't stalk Kibler, but I just happened to read that. It was
okay, like, that seems like a very intimate thing. Social
as
media.
As I was like getting, right. Kill Commander for the fifth time in a row, I was like, that's really interesting.
That was probably his dog.
All right, well, Kibler wants to be super aggressive on the board, and that's certainly the way to play against this Shaman deck.
Yeah, I really like the play here with the 2-2 drops instead of anything else. Like, the Shaman has nothing to answer this, and by playing the 2-2, you guarantee that even if the worst-case scenario hits, and another Ultron comes out, or Totem that's like Searing Totem, you don't lose anything out of it, really.
Mm-hmm. Okay, now this is where the Hunter starts turning the tides. Animal Companion's pretty reasonable because Leok.
Yeah, it's great. That's like the best one.
Yeah, that was like one of the
best. It's the only one that doesn't get punished.
Well, I mean, Abusive Sergeant still works out, right? Like, even if you get Misha.
Yeah. But Misha would just die Lava Burst, and here Leok might stick on the board. Like, it might just leave it because it doesn't seem threatening enough.
That's a trap.
One thing that I can see potentially happening is if Gaara just ends up drawing more direct damage, he can pull it back, but this is already looking really tough because this is some easy trades for Kibler to make onto the Lotheb. Lotheb is supposed to try to get some damage back.
Yeah, but there's no way he's going to be able to do that. Like, Lotheb will deal absolutely no damage unless Kibler lets it get out of hand, I guess. Unless a Flametongue Totem come up to let the healing go back to hand and then Lotheb sticks.
I do want to mention that it does seem like Gaara is pretty screwed here, but if Gaara loses the next one as well, we will have our first triple bench. Six losses straight.
Never
happened before.
You're right. There's going to be the 6-0 in a row. Yeah, we were talking about that like theoretical rare occurrence with the Moz last time.
So. Yeah, Tempo Storm making dreams happen. not the kind of dreams they want them to happen.
Oh, Trip. You're
it's
killing
true,
someone
man.
Right now.
It's too true.
Yeah.
I think here you just...
You have to at least kill a totem to make sure that no Flametongue totem. Like, if you don't want to kill Lothab, then you at least kill the totem.
Well, with that line of play, you're leaving Lothab up. And I don't blame. Seems good to me.
Yeah,
I don't really foresee ways... for him to climb back.
A Storm, I guess, if he plays one of the weird variants that plays Lightning Storm. That's like the only way I could see it, but I've only ever seen like two people play that, and mostly for ladder purposes, not tournaments.
I think the only Storm that's going to save him is like a Storm on like the California data center where the battle server is, maybe.
Right.
Yeah.
You make everything sound so bleak, Crip.
It is this
before
bleak,
I start casting
this
with you, life was good.
Bleak.
Okay.
This is pretty.
Because now the overload is also something that really blocks him from being able to do anything.
But what if he's got lava shock, guys? Stop killing the dream.
Yeah, convert the lava burst into lava shock, and then convert the spider tank
into like...
Teal Bot, and then Lothab can stay Lothab, but just make it one mana instead. Right. Then it's good. Then you're in a good spot.
Well, now that you put it that way.
The reality is the Shaman lost the board, and it's almost it feels like a little too simplified to say it that way, but Shaman lost the board and had no follow-up plays, and that's what makes the deck so frustrating for some players, because it's inconsistencies, and losing this is especially painful, because the theory that I'm going off of is that if that wasn't Zoo, then it probably is Handlock, because Zoo is great at destroying the Shaman. So if it's Handlock, you can beat it with Paladin. Yeah, you can definitely beat it with Shaman. But the problem is, how will the Patron Warrior fare against the Handlock? And that's ultimately where it might be checkmate against
Tempo Storm. It's not impossible.
It's not impossible, but I would say that's where you get cornered if you're Tempo Storm, because that's the matchup that Valiant would be comfortable with.
That would be so cool if like Tempo Storm came back to win this right now, but it just feels so unlikely. It, not impossible, just so unlikely.
Yeah, even with bad matchups, usually you'd expect them to... like, even if the Warlock runs into, like, four bad matchups, it might win just the one, so...
Yeah.
Well, it's got one great matchup.
Yeah, exactly.
And with, I was going to say, with that win, Kibler is the double checkmark. He's going to end two losses less and two wins more than Hyped. At the very, in the current state, at least.
Yeah, there's not going to be a 1v1 duel between them two, unfortunately for Hyped.
Kibler does have the commanding lead.
Yeah, I guess there's a couple of things that you could point at. I think the first is, Kibler was able to time the Priest really well, and that was really important. But again, Temple Storm sending out Hyped, risking him getting benched, and he did. And that ended up causing a snowball of decisions where maybe it's not... Sure, you could go ahead and talk about how the draws decide the outcome of a lot of things in the games. But at the same time, the overall macro strategy of being able to send out the classes and making sure to line things up, was that the point of failure for Temple Storm so far? It's not over yet. We have one more chance. Gaara is going to queue up the Shaman again. It's impossible for him to actually pick a Hunter because there's a Hunter 1. And I'm guessing this is Handlock from Trump. And if it's Handlock, then I feel like Valuetown's favored at like 85% to win the series at this point.
You think that high?
Wow, that's crazy.
Yeah.
Wow. Well, I guess you can't really hold a board with Dark Bomb. Like, you've got Dark Bomb on its own. Double.
It's demons.
1-2 Owls. Yeah, it's a mid-range deck. Still pretty good, though, because... Yeah. Oh, but that hand, though, from Gaara is potentially... a snowball in and of its own, like,
right.
This is dangerous.
Oh, Trump picks up the Flame Imp, though. That's a really big deal. Turn one, yeah. Flame Imp just shuts out all the options from Gaara.
Okay. So, it's not Handlock, it's Zeus, so they just felt like the Hunter was better at taking out the Shaman. I guess in case it's a mid-range Shaman, makes the most sense.
This is so bad, because you don't want to play Cogmaster, but you don't want to play Mechwarper, so you just end up passing your turn one to a Zoo, which might play a 2-drop and then blow you out of the game.
Oh, no. I think you just play nothing. And then next turn you do Mechwarper, coin into Mechwarper, and hope to get a 2-drop mech. I'm actually really surprised that he coined out the Mechwarper there.
Yeah, doesn't want to get blown out of the game. And you know what? Like, in some way, I kind of understand where he's coming from. It's just that I don't think it's going to be a winning play, considering the follow-up that Trump has. It really depends on what, you know, comes out of this.
All right, guys, I did some quick math.
Go.
On my calculator.
Go.
Even if Tempo Storm was favored 60% in every match from this point on, they have a 13% chance to win. So.
And that's assuming you don't take it.
I was off, like, but they're not exaggerating even more. Exactly. If I exaggerated, it's actually in the 90s. Of how much Valuetown's favorite from this point on.
See, if Gaara kind of saved the coin, he would have had the Cogmaster and then Rockbiter on the Flame Imp play there. I don't know. It feels like maybe it was a bit too defensive to coin out the Mechwarper on turn one.
I think. Yeah. At the same time, there's not a lot of mech synergy, so like usually you want to protect Mechwarper because of what it allows you to open up tempo-wise, but because you play Fireguard Destroyers, you're playing the Power Mace and Doomhammers, and you have like the Lotheb and spells, there's not a lot of actual mechs left in the deck outside of the Zap-O-Matic, Spider Tanks, the Yeti, the Shredder, and the Annoyatron. And that sounds like a mouthful, but there's like seven or six cards versus like the Fel Reavers that you had.
Right, in the older list, other yeah.
Stuff. So I think it's less mech dependent, I think.
Fair enough.
I think here he's thinking about rock biting the 2-3 and killing the Imp Gang boss, but he's also probably weighing in the option that if he uses Rock Biter here, his chance to burst out the Zulok is yeah. greatly diminished.
So this is a play that says I've lost the board, and with Defender of Argus, that's almost a certainty. And what Gar's gonna hope to do is that Fireguard Destroyer can help bring back some of that board control, because it can be like a 6-6. But the challenge is, if your opponent has one Power Overwhelming, the game almost feels out of reach, because then you can use this really small minion to take out a big minion, you've overloaded yourself, and he's starting to hit you for 7-8 damage per turn.
Well, I think Fireguard, but don't use the weapon to take out the Imp Gang boss. I think you have to save the weapon buff.
And he's going to actually just pop it right now, get a 5-4, which actually makes sense, because it's forcing your opponent to trade away his entire board.
Right. That's the key.
Yeah. You have most as a follow-up. It's okay.
And this is the point where your opponent draws Implosion.
Oh my god.
we were mentioning that. I was thinking Implosion, because Implosion is actually the nail in the coffin sometimes. But this is also good.
Yeah, I mean, it's going to be really hard just because of the hero power. I think it's going to be hard to push Trump off this game, even if you had a really terrible hand. He could still trade with the board and play anything. Like, you could have like three abusives that do nothing and still get a really commanding lead over the shaman. Put this apple on your
head. I mean, in the current board state, Trump can just kill everything in Gaara's hand and still be ahead.
Is this going to be like the first 6-0? Not quite 6-0, but like 6 wins straight in the entire league. This is the last week. That's eventful.
Yeah, this was really big. I'm not sure how meaningful the win is in terms of the actual score differential. I think if Temple Storm lost 6-0, I think they still make the stage 1.5 playoffs. Yep. But this is still a really big confidence booster, because Diatown now goes, assuming they can close out the win here, which hypothetically should. Still hypothetically should. Mm-hmm. But assuming they can, they're going to be in a really good confidence
position. Wow.
Krip loves that card. Every time he sees that card, he just reacts like insanely. It's true.
I think it's probably going to be a Power 1 play anyway.
Yeah. It's a good nod to make, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I think Gaara needs an Earth Shock into another Rock Biter to win the game.
Would that win it? I think he's still dead.
I don't know
dead.
If he has enough time to do that, though. I think he's dead next turn.
Maybe. Well, Earth Shock.
Because it on 1 or 8-11. Yeah, it would. He would just die to a creature.
Yeah, anything, basically, that gets dropped on the board and enables a juggler. So
Taunt Totem needs to come out here to buy him a little bit of time. And then Gaara needs to magically get a Lightning Storm.
Next turn.
And then Trump has to whiff on draws and not get like Doomguard straight up. That's it.
And Gaara's going to concede it, and Value
Triple Bench
goes for the crazy reverse sweep. And even if they wanted to play now, I guess Temple Storm couldn't. They got no players enabled. That's rough. Yeah.
If they're going to do this, they might as well have lost zero, so then we can call them Tempo 6 Storm. But that's not the right way we can call it, because they won 2 games to start things off. Valuetown.
Right.
Oh,
right.
This is the triple bench stamp. Oh,
this is beautiful.
The dream.
That's right.
I think it's missing a little bit of cool, how to put it, the check marks. There's no design to them. It would be nicer if you had like...
stamp on the Tempo Storm logo. No.
That's good.
Right. All right. Well, look at the standings. It looks like Valuetown is way ahead of everyone. But again, we're going to be seeing Nihilim versus Cloud9 coming right up. So there's a possibility that Nihilim is able to equalize the game wins, you know, by going 6 wins, obviously. And if they stay, then they're going to get top 2, I guess. Valuetown and Nihilim will be our top 2 finalists.
I think top 2 are just what we're getting out of this. I don't know if it actually matters if you're first or second out of the bracket. Top 2 teams advance to the live finals. I don't even think there is a difference in seeding. So,
okay.
I mean,
it's all good.
When the competition is this close, I think seeding is pretty much irrelevant. I think any team that you face is a legitimate threat. So if you're the first seed, you're playing the fourth seed, is that really that big of an advantage? Sometimes you get players you don't want to face because they happen to lose 2 more games in terms of
score.
A small correction, first place gets an advantage in the finale. They get to choose the brackets and the double elimination.
Oh, that's pretty
sweet. Cool.
That's a good advantage.
There's an opportunity for call-outs which is funny because you have three of the nicest guys in the entire league.
Right.
Like, legitimately nice guys. Like, Kibler, Trump, and Dog are all great. Great. Mm-hmm. So I'd be really surprised if they call people out based off of, like, well, we think this team is weak. But I look good to it.
Yeah, they probably respect all of their opponents, so.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Mm-hmm. Thanks so much, guys, for watching. That does it for our first series of the day. We have another one, Cloud9 vs. Nylon, coming up, and we're going to go to a break. But before we do that, we also want to give a shout-out to some of our partners. You see the Alpha Draft logo there on the top left of your screen. You can draft your fantasy team in ATLC and win cash for doing it. So why not earn some Buccarinos while you watch some Hearthstone Arenas?
Buccarinos.
Sign up today for $250. It's a real currency. They're starting to regulate that in the IFC.
Wow.
You can sign up today for $250 and you get a matching deposit bonus. So check it out, alphadraft.com. I also want to give a shout out to the Amazon App Store. You know, you're going to get cards soon, right? For all the TGT card backs.
That's right.
So make sure you get that discount giveaway that we're doing to get 50% off of 40 packs. Just go to teamarcon.com/Amazon or amazon.com/Hearthstone. It's on the links on the Twitch chat, and I'm sure people are going to be able to direct you in case you're lost. We'll be back right after this commercial break. Don't go anywhere. Cloud9 vs. Nylon coming up next.